We published some very rum books to begin with, because you do, when you begin, you pick up anything you can. But our first successful book, which launched us into a lot, it launched us into doing a lot of American publishing, was Norman Mailer's The Naked and the Dead, which we would never have got if it hadn't been turned down by everybody else, because they were all too frightened of the language. It was a war book about soldiers in the Far East. And even, well, I think America was probably almost more prudish than England. You could not print the word fuck. And of course, he wanted, his dialogue, as you know, soldiers, every third word, practically. And there'd been a lot of argument what they should do. Would they put a dash? And honestly, if you put a dash in that book, it would have looked like network. It would have been hopeless. So then, this was really so absurd. It was agreed that they would substitute the word fug. I mean, what could be sillier, in a way, than that? Because it was perfectly obvious to everybody what the word was. Why was it harmless? Because it was F-U-G. And unwritable, because it was F-U-C-K. I mean, the whole thing was so daft. Anyhow, English poems all turned it down, all the big ones that you've been sent to. Well, we were very small, so we must have been, the agents was in a state of despair when it was offered to us. And it was Norman's best book by far. I mean, I hadn't read it for years. I don't know what I would think of it now, but it seemed to me at the time a remarkably good book, and did give you an extraordinarily clear picture of what fighting was like in those awful circumstances. I can to this day remember certain descriptions of manhandling guns through mud and things, which are very vivid and clear. And so we took it on. And we sent out the review copies 3 weeks in advance, like one does. And the literary editor on the Sunday Times left a copy on his desk. And the editor of the Sunday Times came into his office and happened to pick it up and look at it. He was an old man. I can't remember his name, but he was an elderly editor. And he opened it, and there was fug, 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 all the way down on the page. And the next thing we knew, on a Sunday, on the front page of the Sunday Times, written by the editor himself, was this scandalous and awful book was being published, which no decent man could leave where his women or children might see it. Those very words he used. And it was about 8 o'clock in the morning on Sunday, 8:30. André turned up. Bang, bang, bang on the door. And I was in bed, and I got out of bed. And there was he, and he was almost in bed. He pulled on things over his pyjamas. Look, look at this, look at this. And I looked like, horror, what do we get through? We were so naive. We thought, this is the end. This is going to be so awful. Because, in fact, we had quite a big printing of this book, which, if we had to junk it, we would have been completely bust. I mean, our investment in it had been big enough. And I remember we said, well, we better take a copy around to Desmond McCarthy, who André vaguely knew, and beg and beseech him to quickly read it and to say that it was not obscene, that he would be a respectable person. I remember we leapt into André's baby Austin, drove, I can't remember where Desmond McCarthy lived, quite far away, and we got there and we left the copies with our letter beseeching him to help. And on Monday morning, we went into the office, and we could hardly get in through the door because the orders were that deep inside. You had to push the door open. Of course, it was absolutely fabulous. But we still didn't know whether we were going to be able to publish, because there was also an enormous detective who was going around talking to everyone, and now all of us, in a sort of smooth way, trying to get to the bottom of how we could be doing this awful obscenity. And then we had an injunction. We couldn't do anything. We weren't allowed to publish it until it had been raised in the House of Commons and decided whether or not we could publish that book. And there was a 3 weeks, I think, of awful suspense and anxiety. Were we going to be ruined, or were we going to be immensely successful? As we could tell, because the orders went on coming in. And then finally, I think André got someone who, I can't remember who, MP, if his acquaintance, to ask a question in the House, because nothing was happening, nothing was happening. Is this book going to be banned, or is it not? And Sir Hartley Shawcross, it was, made a statement and said he didn't think it was a particularly good book, but it wasn't going to be banned. And we were away. You see, it wasn't only that that book was published, but it meant that agents from then on thought that a bright young house, they're dashing, they're adventurous, they go where other people daren't go. And also gave us a lot of connections in America. I mean, André loved going over. He went over every year to New York, and he made friends with a lot of... We had more American friends, really, than we had English. And from then on, we got a lot of American writers.
Did you get to know Norman Mailer at all?
Yes, he used to come over from time to time.
What can you tell me about Norman Mailer?
It always irritated me about him that I thought later on, I didn't like his other books much, and I thought he talked an awful lot of hogwash, and I used to get very irritated with him, what he said and did, but on the other hand, every time you met him, he was so charming, you couldn't help liking him very much, if you didn't happen to be one of his wives who he was stabbing, but so... I mean, he was very genial and pleasant to meet. But he was an awful old phony a lot of the time, I think.
An awful?
Phony, really. He used to talk such rubbish. He came over once and he wasn't going to give interviews, but we'd got to hire a theatre for him. And he would have this one occasion when... He would get out on the stage and would talk, and all the people who were interested, all the reviewers, everyone could come. They all came docilely and listened to him holding forth. And really, he was talking such codswallop. But nobody said so.